just a few announcements to your attention. In the month of June, we sort of scale back on certain things in June and December. And so there will be no finance committee meeting this month unless Tony decides that we need to have the finance committee. There will be no personnel committee meeting this month, and the deacons will meet at the end of the month instead of the beginning of the month. We will have a Lord's Supper service the second Sunday in July. The big thing that's coming up is Vacation Bible School. June 10th through June 14th, we are going to be hosting Vacation Bible School. And that will be for people, is it first grade through fifth grade? Michelle, is it first grade through fifth grade for VBS? Or is there kindergarten too? First through fifth. And it will be from 5:30 to 8:30. So please tell your friends, tell your children, tell your grandchildren that we are going to have a great time that week. We also have an exercise room over there now. And Brother Stan is in charge of that. And so if you want to know more information about that, talk to him. But you can come. We are usually here 9 to 4 during the week. And we will let you in and you can exercise there if that's what you would like to do. If it's after hours, you need to talk to Stan and he can work out a schedule. But we've got rowing machines in there, some treadmills, all sorts of good things for us. All right, I think that just about covers things. Sure, I'll pray. Gracious God, we love you so much and we thank you for this day. And I thank you for each and every person that is here. Lord Jesus, we pray that you would come and take the seat of honor because we're here to exalt you and to preach your gospel and to share your love with a lost and dying world. Jesus, we thank you that you love every person on this planet and you want to bless them and you want to reveal yourself to them. So I pray that you would just open our hearts and make us able to receive the word that you're going to give us this morning. In that precious sweet name, the name of Christ Jesus, we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen. All right.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning. I am still coming to you sitting down. I'm so sorry. The good news is it is healing. The bad news is my ankle is healing slowly. But I'm going to ask you all to stand as we sing this morning. Get the blood pumping, heart moving.
Hallelujah, for the Lord God Almighty.
Go ahead and greet your neighbor.
Good morning. If you'll make your way back to your seats. Alrighty, so as you make your way back to your seats, I will be doing the scripture reading and also be taking up the offering directly afterwards. So, our scripture reading is in John chapter 14, starting in verse 1. It says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you may also be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going." Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for the chance to just come to worship in your house. I thank you for everyone who's here and watching online as well. God, I pray that you'd help us to just bring your word to them. I pray for the praise team as they continue to worship, and Brother Rob as he brings a message soon. I pray that you would help us to use the offerings as well, just to continue to further your kingdom, and here in Lockhart and around the world as we plant missionaries and just try to reach others for you. And I pray this in your name. Amen.
Thank you, Matt. So the young men of our church are going to come around now and collect the offering. You can stay seated while they are passing that plate, but we do invite you to stand and sing with us once you're done.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Who shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, who shall I fear? Whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory.
You are faithful, you are faithful. So much for this gift of this morning, this opportunity to be together and to worship you, Lord. Thank you for always giving us what it is we need to hear when we need to hear it. Lord, please be with our pastor now as he speaks to us and preaches the message. Let his words sink in and go to our hearts so that we can carry them with us throughout this week. It is in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Kayla. If you would, take your copy of God's Word and let's turn this morning Hope Children's Church. If you are fifth grade and under, feel free to make your way to the back. They've got some exciting things planned. And I think they're also going to be talking a little bit about VBS. So kids, you'll want to know more about it. If you want to take your copy of God's Word, and let's turn this morning to Galatians chapter 2. We're going to be looking at verses 1 through 10. And specifically, we're going to be talking about how to be a mission-minded church. Jesus Christ, when he was talking to the disciples in Matthew chapter 16, after Peter made the declaration that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God, Jesus looked at Peter and the other disciples and said, "It is upon this rock that I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it." We are called to build this church upon the declaration that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that he has come to this earth, that God loved the world so much that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. We are called to share that good news with a world that is lost, wandering in darkness. They don't know what to believe. And so this morning, we're going to be looking specifically at Paul's life and Paul's calling. I invite you to stand in honor and in reverence to the reading of the holy, inspired Word of God. We're going to be looking at Galatians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. I will be reading out of the English Standard Version. Starting in verse 1, it says, "Then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem with Barnabas, taking Titus along with me. I went up because of a revelation and set before them, though privately before those who seemed influential, the gospel that I proclaimed among the Gentiles to ensure that I was not running or had not run in vain. But even Titus, who was with me, was not forced to be circumcised, though he was a Greek. Yet because of false brothers secretly brought in, who slipped in to spy out our freedom that we have in Christ Jesus so that they might bring us into slavery, to them we did not yield in submission even for a moment, so that the truth of the gospel might be preserved for you. And for those who seem to be influential, what they were makes no difference to me. God shows no partiality. Those, I say, who seemed influential added nothing to me. On the contrary, when they saw that I had been entrusted with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been entrusted with the gospel to the circumcised, for he who works through Peter for the apostolic ministry to the circumcised worked also through me for mine to the Gentiles. And when James and Cephas and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to Barnabas and me, that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. Only they ask us to remember the poor, the very thing that I was eager to do." My friends, challenges face us. There is so much going on in the world, and people are looking for an answer. And even among fellow Christians, there are challenges. And these aren't meant to discourage us, but to strengthen us in our faith and commitment to evangelical missions and spreading the gospel throughout the world. These trials are just part of our spiritual journey. This morning, at the conclusion of this service, we're going to have a short church conference business meeting, and I'm going to present Tiago and Elaine and their daughter for membership. In fact, Laura was just baptized this past Sunday or two ago, and so we're going to be voting on them, and we're also going to be voting that we will be a sponsoring church, a mother church, a sending church, to help plant a new church in the Sanford area. So go ahead and be seated, and then as you're seated, we're going to go to the Lord in a word of prayer. Dear gracious God, we thank you for this day and your many blessings. And Lord, I pray that you would speak to our hearts and show us what we as a church are supposed to do. Not because we live in Orlando necessarily or because we're Baptists, but because we have believed in your gospel. and have accepted the commission to go and share your love, your grace, your mercy, your forgiveness with the lost and dying world. I pray that you will anoint this service, that you will be pleased with what you hear and see, and touch our hearts and open our eyes so that we might be able to obey what you've called us to do. In the sweet and precious name of Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray these things. And all God's people said, amen, amen. It's great to see you here this morning. I do want to emphasize that one of the things that preaching the gospel entails for us, and this is something that I hope you see in my life, is that when I or anybody else steps into this pulpit, I'm not here to give you my opinion. My opinion really doesn't matter, and I know that there's things, you know, for example, in Sunday school, we have, you know, interesting discussions every Sunday. In my class just this past Sunday, we were talking about, do we follow Romans 13, where it says, obey the government, and Paul, whenever he was struck by the order of the high priest, cursed the high priest, and then he apologized because he said he's not supposed to speak ill of the leaders. And so, you know, we had a very good discussion. But everything that we as Christians do in our life should be based on this holy word. And so one of the goals that I try to do is I try to look into the passage of Scripture, and I hope that you can see this. I'm trying to draw out Paul's outline, not my outline. I'm trying to find out what the Holy Spirit spoke to Paul, because underneath this writing, underneath this ink, underneath this screen in my case, and the words that are there, there are underlying principles that are eternal and have the power to transform this church, transform your family, and transform your lives. I want to tell you this morning, more than anything else, that Jesus has the answer to your problems, to your struggles, to the things that you feel like are just controlling your life, and that he actually has the answers. So let's sort of walk through this and sort of get an idea. And basically what we're seeing here in chapter 2 is Paul is giving his testimony. Paul was an apostle. He was also a pastor. He is referred to as a pastor, an episkopos, a presbyteros in the Greek. He also was referred to as a church planter. He planted churches. And so let's just sort of walk through this. Paul gives the Galatians a summary of his spiritual journey. Now, your spiritual journey is going to be different from Paul's. My spiritual journey is going to be different from yours. But all of our spiritual journeys, if we're going to find salvation, are going to bring us to the foot of the cross. And we're going to be talking about what Jesus did. And then part of our job as Christians, the reason why God doesn't just take us home as soon as we're saved, is we are called to become vessels that go out and communicate his love to a world that hasn't heard the name of Jesus or doesn't know what Jesus really did to them. So let's sort of walk through this. The very first thing we find here is that we must support men whom God calls to serve as pastors and ministers. In Paul's testimony here, the first thing we find is that Paul was not a lone ranger. Paul actually ventures to Jerusalem to talk with Peter and with James and John to make sure that they are on the same page. Now, obviously, and Paul stresses this, his call was from God. Ultimately, he is answerable to God for what he does do or doesn't do. However, he wanted to make sure, and you know, we're going to get into this more fully, is Paul was willing to be accountable to other Christians, other Christian leaders, so that he even says, so that his race or his run may not be in vain. That he wanted to make sure he was on the right track, and he wanted to also hear and make sure that the church in Jerusalem, because he's going to Jerusalem. So Paul explains, then after 14 years, I went up again to Jerusalem. Now, this is a little complicated, but I want to give you a little background. It says he went up again to Jerusalem. This is his third trip to Jerusalem. 17 years now have passed from when Paul, who used to be Saul. He used to persecute Christians. Then Jesus appeared to him on the road to Damascus. He got saved, and God called him to be an apostle. That was 17 years ago. If you go back to Galatians 1:18 in the first chapter, you'll see that he spent his first 3 years in Saudi Arabia studying the Word of God, working with other Christians, because he wanted to get a good foundation. He knew the Old Testament backwards and forwards. But he, even after, and he probably had a genius IQ, he studied under Gamaliel, he was first in his class, you know, and yet he still took 3 years of study before he actually decided to go out and start preaching the gospel on a regular basis. So after that trip, after those 3 years in Saudi Arabia, he goes to Jerusalem. So let's talk about this. When was his first trip? This first trip, and I love this because Acts is a history book. And Acts, the book of Acts, records some of Paul's missionary journeys. So Paul's first trip to Jerusalem is mentioned in Acts chapter 9. Let me just read it to you. And you'll understand why I'm giving you this background when we get further into the message. Acts 9, 26 and 27 says this. And when he, talking about Paul, had come to Jerusalem, he attempted to join the disciples. And they were all afraid of him, for they did not believe he was a disciple. But Barnabas took him and brought him to the apostles. So after 3 years, now Paul knew that he was called to be a minister. There was a calling on Paul's life, and he knew that God wanted him to even be an apostle. So he goes to Jerusalem, get this, and a lot of people don't realize this, he wasn't accepted by the other apostles. After the first 3 years, in fact, they were scared of him. They were worried that he was a spy, that he was a plant, that he was going to weasel his way in, get a whole bunch of names, and then turn them in to the Jewish leaders, and that they would all be stoned. And so I want to point out to you that becoming a minister, becoming a pastor, isn't something that happens overnight. I went to school at Southwestern, and I felt called into the ministry when I was 14 years old. I knew that I was meant to be a pastor, to be in the ministry. In fact, whenever I asked Michelle to marry me, she actually looked at me and she said, I've been called to be a pastor's wife. Are you sure you're going to be a pastor? Because she knew what her calling was too. And I said, that's one thing I can tell you. I handed her the ring and I said, I know I'm called to be a minister, and I know I'm supposed to marry you because you just said you need to be a minister's wife. Hey, that sort of works, doesn't it? You know? But we find here that being a servant of God and being a leader in the church is not something that happens overnight. His second trip is mentioned in Acts 11:29-30. So the disciples determined, everyone according to his ability, to send relief to the brothers living in Judea, which is Jerusalem. And they did so, sending it to the elders by the hand of Barnabas and Saul. Okay, now at this point, they're still calling him Saul. But now, look what's happened. After studying the scripture and studying the gospel and everything that he could get his hands on, he then finds Barnabas. And Barnabas is willing to be his mentor, to be able to take him in and introduce him and tell the apostles and the other Christians, Saul, who's now Paul, is for real. And what's interesting is, Saul is his name, but he changes his name, or God changes his name, to Paul. You know what the name Paul means? In Greek, it means small. Isn't that interesting that he wanted to change his name to small? Paulus. And it's a Greek word that is very well used throughout the Bible and means small. But the point that I'm wanting to make out is Saul, or Paul, was also willing to find a mentor and make him accountable to a Christian that was stronger, to somebody that had been a Christian longer. But I love Barnabas too, because look what happens to Barnabas. He took Saul in, Saul becomes Paul, and Paul becomes greater than Barnabas. And one of the things we as Christians need to do is, when we support people that are going into the ministry, and maybe you're called into some type of Christian ministry, you need to first study then you need to find a mentor, somebody that's going to help you. But it takes time. But Barnabas was willing to help Paul, even though there was a good chance, and Barnabas may have even known this, that Paul was going to be a greater and be more effective than Barnabas was. And yet Barnabas was selfless. He was a helper. And then the third trip is in Acts 15. And this is called the Jerusalem Council. There was a little conflict there. And we're going to see in Scripture today that there was conflict. But in Acts 15, 2, it says, after Paul and Barnabas, notice it was used to be Barnabas and Saul. Now it's Paul and Barnabas. Paul has become greater. After Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and debate with them, Paul and Barnabas and some of the others were appointed to go to Jerusalem to the apostles and elders about the question. So now we're dropping in to Galatians. This is where we're at in Galatians chapter 2. But the point I want to make is it took 17 years for Paul to be recognized by the church as an apostle. This brings us to, and I wrote here, let young Christians learn from this, that they must be willing to wait and be patient until they have enough experience and service to give them the right to be a church leader. Church leaders should not be novices. They shouldn't be too young. They need to be tested and tried. This brings us to point number two. Realize that God's call is always a call to preach the gospel. No matter what area a person is going into in ministry, it may be in a Christian radio station, it may be being a Christian therapist, a Christian counselor, but ultimately the goal, and this even goes back to Matthew 16, where Jesus says, and it's upon this rock I will build my church. Jesus wasn't saying he was going to build his church upon Peter. He was saying that he was going to build the church upon Peter's statement that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Christian churches and this church will stand or fall whether it proclaims and lives by the gospel and the liberating grace of God, or whether its life degenerates into some sort of social club or self-salvation thing. We are only saved by the grace of God. And that's one of the things that Paul keeps bringing out. It's not by works. But this church will stay healthy and strong as long as we make sure that exalting and glorifying Christ and sharing the gospel is the number one responsibility. Churches very easily can turn into a social club or a community help organization. And all those things are important. In fact, if you read to the end in verse 10, it actually says, remember the poor, do things in the community. But that's not our primary responsibility. Our primary responsibility is to tell people about Jesus Christ. For that reason, the doctrine of atonement and the cross must be preached and be at the heart of this church and our mission. Lockhart Church will stand or fall on whether we are willing to proclaim the gospel and support church missions and planting. Listen, 10% of everything you give to this church and put in the plate or give online, 10% we tithe to go help other churches get started. Chiago has been accepted. His call has been approved. He's gone through the paperwork and he even had to take a psych test, and Elaine had to take a psych test. It's a very stringent process, and he has been called to be a church planter in the state of Florida. He's going to work, but he still needs a supporting church, a loving church, somebody that's willing to come along inside him, and I want to be his Barnabas. And my prayer, let me tell you this, my prayer and hope is that he just soars and is so much better of a pastor than I am. And a church planner. And I was a church planner 30 years ago. Michelle and I, God used us to plant Cornerstone Baptist Church, and it's still there to this day. And we ended up buying property and going through three building programs. And so I have a little experience in it. But I hope that he is even more successful. I love helping people become the leaders that God has called them to be and for you to be. If God has called you to do something special, we want to help you with that. So we need to tell people that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. We must be evangelical, we must be gospel-oriented, and we must be mission-minded if we too are going to attack the gates of hell and watch them fall. This brings us to point number three. We must help ministers anticipate and deal with problems as they serve. This is where accountability comes in. I know this is a shock to you, but did you know that church and Christians can get into arguments in church? Can you believe that? Well, guess what? Even in Acts, even in the New Testament church, they would have squabbles. They would have questions. And the word that's used there is actually a dissension arose. And it was on the issue of whether or not the Gentiles needed to convert to Judaism and be circumcised and follow the Jewish laws before they could become a Christian. And the one thing that he emphasizes here, Titus was a Gentile. Titus was a Greek. And one of the things he writes to the Galatians is he says, when I went to Jerusalem, they didn't make Titus, who is a Gentile Christian, get circumcised. Only the Jewish Christians kept circumcision. Barnabas may be said in a certain sense to have made Paul what he became. He brought Paul out of obscurity. He put him in the front line. He introduced them to the apostles. He sat down and said, now, Paul, we've got a question here. We want to make sure that you are preaching the gospel that the disciples see, because the apostles, the 11 apostles other than Paul, they'd actually lived with Christ for 3.5 years. They had heard Jesus from his own lips tell them what they were supposed to preach and what they were supposed to teach. So Barnabas, along with the church at Ephesus, says, you need to go back to Jerusalem and you need to sit down with the apostles and tell them that you've been called to be an apostle. Now, I truly believe that Matthias is not the 12th apostle. Now, remember in Acts chapter 1 and chapter 3, they rolled dice and chose Matthias to take Judas's place. I believe Paul is the one that Jesus chose to take Matthias's place. You know, when it talks about the 12 gates having the name of the apostles above each, you know, gate, I believe that Paul's name is going to be up there instead of Matthias. I could be wrong, but in Galatians 1:1, Paul even says, I am an apostle, not called by men or chosen by men, but chosen by God. I think that was just a little spin in there saying, you may have chosen Matthias to take Judas's place, but Jesus chose me to take Judas's place. But that's a side note. It's important, and this is the third point, we must help ministers anticipate and deal with problems as they serve. Preachers need friends. Preachers need mentors. Preachers need a support network, a group. In fact, let me just put down what I wrote. Each pastor, minister, or church planner needs mentors, companions, a network of friends, accountability partners, and a support system to help them through the challenges. We are a church family, and families stick together. And we're going to be voting on them to be part of our family. In fact, they want to keep coming to this church. So their church, when they plan it, will probably be in the afternoon or evenings. Now let me stop there for a second. I told Tiago that he could fish off my pier. You know what that means? That means that if there's anybody in here that wants to go help him start a church, and they go away from this church to go to that church, I will be so excited and thrilled, I will be overjoyed. Because I know when a church like us sends some people out to start a new church, what does God do? He always replaces and multiplies the people in this church. And so if there's someone here that wants to help Tiago, even if you want to stay in the church, I'm not telling you have to leave to help him. But his service is going to be in the afternoon and evening, and he's going to need to have some critical mass when he starts having his, his home Bible studies. I mean, literally, this is called a cold start. I had a warm start. I had about 39 people helping me, including Michelle and I, 39 people. His is a cold start. He's literally going into a community, and he's just going to start sharing the gospel. And Paul used to do that. So it works. It happens. But if some of you were wanting to help him get this started, I would love it. I'd get all excited. We'd bring you to the front of the church if you don't mind that. And I would say, we're going to anoint them with oil and then send them out to be apostles. And the word apostle means missionary. Y'all realize that. The word missionary isn't in the Bible. The word sent out one or apostle is. And so when you see the word apostle or the gift of apostleship, it's the gift of being a missionary, planting new churches and going to places that haven't heard the gospel. Why do I say all this? And this is going to be hard for me. I got a phone call on Monday, and it was very upsetting. A friend of mine and a fellow pastor who is in one of the most healthy churches. It's growing, it's vibrant. My southern friends used to say he could really shuck the corn. He knew how to preach. I mean, he was such a good preacher. He actually taught things like preaching classes. He took his life last week. He had just come back from Greece after, spending 14 days in Greece. And it breaks my heart. And it's somebody that if I were to mention the church, you probably don't know his name, but if I were to mention church, you'd recognize the church. I mean, the church is reeling. His family is reeling. They're so upset. And the question that I have to ask myself is, how can that happen? I mean, this guy was one of these guys that I would go to ask for advice because he had been through so much. He was so good at resolving conflict. And then he takes his own life. And so I realized that when Satan, the devil, can isolate a pastor or a minister, even a godly man, that minister can succumb to depression, discouragement, or even sexual temptation that can destroy his ministry, destroy his family, and destroy his life. I have been under spiritual attack at times. There have been times that I have wrestled with just severe depression where I didn't want to get out of bed and come to church. Now, fortunately, I'm in a good place now. I look forward to seeing you all every Sunday. I can feel the love. But you know, it's because I had friends in this church. There are people that I could go to that I could, share my hurts with. And you all comforted me there. And some of them are even passed away. I'll even tell you one. Sonia Griffin. How many of y'all remember Sonia? Oh, I loved her. And every so often she would come into the church and she would just sit down and she'd say, "Pastor, how are you doing? What can I do for you? Anything you tell me goes no further." We went over to Dan and Janet's last night. They served us dinner. And without even asking, she says, "Preacher, you can tell us anything and it's not going to go anyplace else." Preachers need that. We need people as well. And Tiago and Elaine, they're going to need friends that will protect them and not be judgmental. We're human. Listen, we pastors, we are broken. I'm just telling you right now, we're still sinners. We are no different from any person sitting in this pew today. And we need each other. And so, but if Satan, and I think of that, one of these safari things, I was watching a safari show, I can't remember, it was on National Geographic, and the water buffalo, when the lions attack, they get in a circle, you know what I'm talking about? And they keep the young ones and the tough ones stay around the circle. But what those lions try to do is they try to get a water buffalo isolated, because they know if they get it isolated, they can bring him down. And it's the same thing with pastors. Pastors need to have a support system. They need to have a church family. They need to have a group that they can call on and get honest advice. And you could ask Tiago, if there's an area in his life that I think that he needs to work on, as basically his, you know, supporting pastor. I'm going to tell him. But I'm telling it because I love him and I want him to be the best. I want him to be better than me. And he can be with the proper support. This brings us to point number four. We must defend and preserve sound biblical teaching. Read through these verses. I'm not going to point them all out, but the main thrust of this entire passage, these 10 verses, is they want to make sure their gospel is the right gospel. We see that here. Just as Paul fought against false brothers, in fact, the Greek word there, you would recognize it. It's pseudo, false, and then there's adelphos, where we get Philadelphia. False brothers, pseudo brothers, pseudo Adelphia. And basically, these were individuals that acted like Christians. They maybe have even thought and embraced certain things about Christ, but they weren't true believers because they did not teach and believe the real gospel. And so it said they snuck in and actually caused trouble for Paul and Titus and Barnabas and the others. And this is something else. Whenever I was a church planter, there was something, and this happens a lot. There are people that bounce from churches to church. They stir things up, you know, they stir the pot, make it smell, and then they go someplace else. Well, one of the things that Geauga's going to have to watch out for are these people that want to come to his church, not to help him, but to make it into a church that they want. He is going to be the vision caster. He is the one that God has touched and anointed and said, you are going to be the church planter. And there's always these people that want to be a big fish in a little pond. And I had one. I won't mention names. I never mention names. But he and his wife came into the church, and they worked real hard for a little while. He even, when we lost our worship leader, he actually became worship leader for a little while. And then one day he comes to me and he says, Pastor Rob, he says, God spoke to me. I said, okay, all right, what did he say? He says, we need to leave the Southern Baptist Convention and we need to be an independent Baptist church. and I said, well, when God says that to me, I will let you know. And he goes, no, God told me to tell you that's what we're supposed to do. And I said, talk to God and ask him to come to me personally. Okay? He says, no, it doesn't work that way. I've got a gift. And I said, you may. And to be honest, we had to sit down with the chairman of the deacons from our mother church, First Baptist Church of Dover, and the pastor, and sit him down and say, we are going to stay in the affiliated with Southern Baptist. We've got a support group here. And so he goes, well, it's obvious that you're not going to do God's will, and so I guess I need to leave the church. And he looked at me, and I said, I think that's a good idea. And he goes, what? I said, yeah, I think it's a good idea. If God's leading you in a different direction, you need to go to a different church. And that didn't settle real well with him. But the truth of the matter is, we need to keep to the vision and keep to the gospel, and we need to defend and preserve the vision and the calling, and specifically preaching the gospel. I was talking to Tiago the other day, and I said, always try to bring your preaching around to the cross. No matter where you start, finish at the cross, because that's where salvation and the work of God takes place. So, and I've got a lot of illustrations here, but two more points. God is impartial. God is impartial, but he calls pastors to reach different people groups. The church he sets up is going to be different from Lockhart. Why? Because by doing so, he will be able to reach people that wouldn't be interested in coming to our church. When Michelle and I were planting the church, Cornerstone, we were only a half a mile from First Baptist Church of Brandon. And the pastor of that church came to me and said, I don't like you planting a church so close to my church. And I said, Pastor, I promise you, the people that we are going to attract are not going to be the people that you attract. We are not going to take away any, and we never did. In the 12 and a half years that I'm there, not one person moved their membership from First Baptist to our church. Because the people that were going there liked the big choir, they liked, you know, all the programs and stuff. And we were a small family church, you know, we were a small church. And so the truth of the matter is, Paul is saying, God has called me to reach the uncircumcised, but Peter and James and John, they've been called to reach the circumcised. Now we do know that later on, John branches out, and John, the apostle, the beloved one, ends up going up and sharing and helping Paul with planting churches. But that is totally different. Galatians 2:7 says this, on the contrary, when they saw that I had been entrusted with the gospel to the uncircumcised, just as Peter had been entrusted with the gospel to the circumcised, for he who worked through Peter for his apostolic ministry to the circumcised worked also through me for mine to the Gentiles. And when James and Cephas and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given to me, they gave the right hand of fellowship to Barnabas and me, that we should go to the Gentiles and they to the circumcised. So basically they said, we're cool with this. You go to the Gentiles, share with them the gospel, tell them about Jesus, and we will continue trying to minister to the Jewish people around Judea and Jerusalem, which makes total sense. And so the point that I want to make out is that he's going to have a different vision and a different idea about his church than what we're doing here. But we can still extend to him the right hand of fellowship. We can pray for him. We can commission him. We can send him out. And we can be a part of his blessings. We can actually, that we're going to be doing what God has called us to do. And this brings us to the last point. Ministry includes helping the poor and the marginalized in society. Yes, we have to share the gospel. But we also, as a secondary ministry, should be helping people in other areas. Whether it's helping the poor, having, you know, a clothes closet or a food pantry, or right now we've got some individuals that are helping tutor children that are over there. Our ministry has really focused over towards the school and the Spread the Word Club, things like that. But one of the things that churches should be doing is that they should be active 24/7, not just Sundays and Wednesday nights. They should be doing things throughout the week. That's why we're spending time collecting money for the Winter Park Pregnancy Center. That's because and that's the reason we're collecting money for the Florida Baptist Children's Home, or for North American Mission Board, or for the International Mission Board. We need to be involved in other ministries where we open our doors. I guess, is it this Sunday? This Tuesday, People of Lockhart will be here at our church. That's a ministry. In fact, if you want to come and find out what's going on with the construction that they're going to start doing on 414, come here Tuesday night. But we need to have a footprint and a presence in the community. Meeting people's spiritual needs also involves meeting people's physical needs and emotional needs. Jesus fed the 5,000, and then he also fed the 4,000 as he shared his gospel. He met their physical needs so that they would be more open to hearing about their spiritual needs and getting them filled. A person will not hear a preacher's message if their stomach is growling too loudly. Amen? We Baptists like to eat. So the truth of the matter is, as a church, we need to support godly ministries and ordain godly people to preach the gospel. And so the truth of the matter is, we have an opportunity to do that today. We're going to have a hymn of invitation, and then I will call the business meeting to order. You can only vote if you are a member in full standing. In other words, you've gone through the membership class, you've actually been voted on by the church, just like we're going to do with them. But if you're not a member in full standing, or if you're just a regular attender or a visitor, you are welcome to stay. And, you know, I may even be willing to handle a question or two, but you've heard him preach, you've watched him baptized, I've had a chance to meet with them and take them through the information of the new members class. I did it one-on-one because they needed to step up the process. But let's stand and sing a hymn. If you are not saved, let's all stand. But if you're not saved, this is your opportunity to profess that Jesus Christ is Lord and to trust him and to receive him today. If you want to join the church, be a candidate to join the church. If you just want to rededicate your life to the Lord, these are all things that you can do. So let's all sing two stanzas, and then we'll have the church conference.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling. Calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting and watching. Watching for you and for me.
You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to call to order. I'd like to call to order the special church conference of Lockhart Baptist Church on June 2nd. June 2nd. And so we're here. We can only handle two things today, since this is a special call business meeting or church conference. One is to vote Chiago and Elaine and Laura into church membership, and then to become a sending church to support the church plant. Now, I do want to mention that Chiago has already been accepted as a missionary by the North American Mission Board and the Florida Baptist Convention. I've been in contact with the leadership there, and everything is a go. What they will do is they will supply, they call it pastoral assistance, or they used to whenever I was a church planter, for 4 years. And they will also supply his health insurance the first year. What I'm hoping is after we get this building paid off, we can begin helping him out a little financially as well. Right now, we will bring him on, and ultimately he would become what we refer to as our mission pastor. The deacons are going to be working with him. We're not going to ordain him for the ministry right away, even though usually when you take a position, you get ordained pretty quick. But we're going to be working with that. The Bible says that he needs to be tested first, and that the deacons need to get to know him well enough that they feel comfortable recommending him to the church. The last church that he left at, his pastor was a little frustrated with him when he left. And so we do believe in church discipline and in Matthew 18. And so the deacons requested that Chiago write the previous pastor a nice letter apologizing if there's anything that he had done to contribute to his frustration, and that he had said a few things that maybe he should have left unsaid. And so that letter has been sent, that email has been sent in the form of an email, and there's been no response yet, but I had a chance to read the email and I'm satisfied. I feel like that he has done due diligence, that he harbors no hard feelings against this other pastor. And you know, I know this other pastor well, and I'm sure he's going to receive it well too. But we just wanted to make sure that that Chiago wasn't bringing any baggage with him, you know what I mean? Because we are going to see this pastor in our GOBA meetings and that kind of thing, our Greater Orlando Associational meetings. So you have had a chance to hear Chiago preach. He also gave his testimony. I'm willing to entertain one or two quick questions if somebody has a question. I am going to, technically, the money will be sent to this church and we will be the one who pay him. I have the power, if I were to ever find out something, I can stop the payments at any time. I don't know if you remember, we had a Spanish church over here that we were sending church for, that Spanish church for a few years, and something happened and we cut off support right away because something inappropriate happened. And so I will be meeting with Chiago on a monthly basis. In fact, we've cleared an office over there so that if he wants the old music room where Chris Freimeyer used to have, it's all clean. If you wanna, Carolyn worked real hard this week to get it ready for him. But I will meet with Chiago at least on a monthly basis. We will have goals, we will have benchmarks, and I will be a mentor and a support for him. If I see that there's something that he needs to improve on, I will gently and lovingly give him constructive criticism. He knows that I only want the best for him and Elaine, and so he has already been very, very receptive to any suggestions that I've had. He's always received them very well and never gotten defensive. So, are there, Dottie?
How was the area in Sanford chosen?
It is one of the fastest growing areas. It's near the airport. And the question is, how was the location chosen? And it was chosen in coordination for Florida Baptist Convention, North American Mission Board, plus the vision that God gave Chiago. But it's all been cleared. It's one of the fastest growing areas in Sanford, and there aren't enough churches. It's all new, it's all apartments going up and houses and stuff like that. And so he's going to specifically be targeting that area north of Sanford. So good question. Anybody else? Okay. Do I, first of all, have a motion that them be accepted into membership? Dale makes the motion, Kayla seconds. Any concerns? Then all those in favor signify by uplifted hand. Any opposed likewise? All right, y'all are members now. That was quick and easy. Okay. Chiago and Elaine, come on up here. You're gonna have to get used to being put on display in front of people. Come on up here. Do you have any questions specifically? I did ask the question, so she doesn't have to answer it. I did ask if Elaine was in total 100% support of this, because you know, from history, a wife can make or break a man's ministry. And she said that she is 100% supportive, right? All right. Okay, any questions for Chiago? Well, you must have passed the muster. So, do I hear a motion that we become that all we're doing is voting on becoming a sending church to support him in a church plant? Every home missionary has to have a church as a home base. That's what we're voting on. We'll be his home base. Is it coming from the deacons? And so it doesn't need to have a second, okay? Brother Donald, why don't you come up here? Or just stand up there and make the motion as the deacon. Thank you, Don. And this is not for ordination. This will come in the future after more deliberations and seeing how things are going. But we don't need a second. Any comments or questions? All those in favor signify by an uplifted hand. Any opposed? And it's okay to vote no. I mean, I just want to let you know, don't feel pressured into anything. All right, and the motion is carried. We are now ascending church. You can tell Brother James Peoples that you're going to prove. All right, I'm going to ask them to stand out front so that you can talk to them as you're leaving. And I'm going to ask Ted, who's also a wonderful lay minister. He won't accept it, but he is a lay minister here at the church. I just love him. And so, Ted, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer? And then we'll be talking more about ordination and things like that later on. So, all right, if you'll head down front with me.
Okay, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are awesome. And you always have a calling out there for each and every one of us in one way or another. And we praise you for this calling you've had with our brother Thiago and his family, that you would be with him, lead and direct, that people would come to know you more, Lord Jesus. Come to know you, period, in the northern Sanford area. We trust you in and through it completely. Now, Lord, as we go, I pray that you go with us, fill us with your peace. And let us know that you're always near and that we can trust you in all things. We praise you, we honor you, and we glorify you in Jesus' precious name. Amen.